Morning, church. Love to tell you that I bring greetings from our pastor, but I think that would probably be a lie. When I left her this morning, she'd been up all night with stomach flu and was kind of just balled up, and said, good luck. But I know that she loves us, and she loves you, and she would want to be here. Those of us that were all hanging out with her last night, sorry about your luck. Yeah. Anyway, pray for her. She was not feeling at all well this morning. She was literally up all night, every moment of it, I think. So, anyway. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus, but to trust and obey. Trust and obey. I don't know if our pastor's ever said to you, one of her main directives in her life, especially in leading worship, is, and I can't remember who to attribute the quote to, but she believes this. She believes that part of leading worship is arranging the contingencies for an encounter with the divine. Arranging the contingencies for an encounter with the divine. That's part of what she lives by. Have you ever heard her say that? Anybody heard her say that? No? It's there. And it's an important part of that. And so every little part of worship for her, she prays over and asks for the Holy Spirit to lead, guide, and direct her in all she does. And so that hymn right before this sermon is just like that. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. The essence of the sermon and the word this morning is just that. Trust and obey. Meditate on that while we share together this message. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. We pray for your Holy Spirit now to lead, guide, and direct us in our worship of you. May that be true, Lord. Thank you. Amen. Today we hear a fifth question that Jesus asked in as part of this seven-week sermon series, the questions that Jesus asked. And our question today comes from the Gospel of Luke, the sixth chapter. This chapter is an important one in the book as it contains Jesus' Sermon on the Plain. Now, we've all heard of the Sermon on the Mount, right? Well, this is not that. This is the Sermon on the Plain. The Sermon on the Mount very often overshadows it, and we get to hear a lot about it, and that's because the Sermon on the Mount encompasses about three chapters in the Gospels. The Sermon on the Plain is much shorter. It's just a couple verses in the Gospel of Luke. And let's look at those verses right now, verses 13 through 19 in the sixth chapter of Luke. They set the scene for us. And when day came, he called his disciples and chose 12 of them, whom he also named apostles: Simon, whom he named Peter, and his brother Andrew, and James, and John, and Philip, and Bartholomew, and Matthew, and Thomas, and James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon, who was called the Zealot, and Judas, son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who would become a traitor. He came down with them and stood on a level place with a great crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all over Judea, Jerusalem, and the coast of Tyre and Sidon. They had come to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. And those who were troubled with unclean spirits were cured, and all in the crowd were trying to touch him, for power came out of him and healed all of them. Obviously, from this text, people had heard of this great preacher and teacher and healer. There were people everywhere trying to get close enough to hear him and touch him. Think about the end of the Super Bowl. A mass of people wanted to get close to Tom Brady. so many that you could hardly move when you got closer to him. They wanted to hear what he had to say. And yes, they wanted to touch him if they could, to be able to tell their friends on Monday, "I got this close to Tom Brady," or "I touched his elbow." People were coming from all over Judea and Jerusalem and the coast of Tyre and Sidon, and Jesus was quickly becoming a very big deal. And he came off the mountain with his 12 newly chosen disciples who had no idea what was coming next. He found a level space and he began to teach them. He spoke to all people saying, "Blessed are you who follow God's ways, and woe to you who don't." He taught that his followers should love their enemies and not judge others without first judging oneself with the same criteria. He compared a person who is truly blessed by God as a good tree who bears good fruit. Think about bananas. He said that if you truly have been called and claimed and changed by God, then the evidence of that will be plain for all to see. You love those who hate you and forgive those who hurt you because your heart and life has been changed from a picture of selfishness and self-centeredness to a life of serving him. Now, as he brings this important sermon to a close, he knocks it out of the ballpark by asking this question. And here it is, our question for today. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, but not do what I say? Why do you call me Lord, Lord, but not do what I say? This is a rubber meets the road talk, folks, at this point. In essence, Jesus is asking them and you and I this. What are you going to do with the teaching you've just heard? This is a question every Bible-loving, Jesus-following, evangelical preacher is quietly asking at the end of every sermon. Preacher's not asking, "Did you like my sermon? Was it good today?" No decent preacher cares if you like his or her sermon. What we care about is, how is it going to impact your life? How will it impact your life from here on out for the kingdom of God? There's a story of a man who went to hear a great Welsh preacher in London. He was highly convicted of the changes that would need to be made in his life and the life of his wife in order to obey the things they'd heard that day. They walked out of the chapel in silence, considering the implications of that message that had come to them, all the changes that would have to take place, counting the cost of serving Christ. Finally, he turned to his wife and said, "He could make you believe that black was white. Of course, it was just the eloquence of the preacher. It was all the power of that man's rhetoric. And they were smart enough to spot that. They'd seen through the smokescreen of his preaching abilities. They didn't have to change. After all, they had a fairly reasonable lifestyle. And they wouldn't. And they didn't." Years later, they were still quite set against the demands of Christ's gospel. People came from all over Judea and Jerusalem and from the coast of Tyre and Sidon to do what? The text tells us they came to hear and to be healed. They didn't come to listen. They came to hear and be healed, to get something for themselves. or perhaps just a gawk, or appreciate Jesus' great oratorical skills so that they could go back home, tell their neighbors they saw the great preacher. Why do we come here on Sunday morning? Are we coming because it's what we've been taught to do? Are we coming because we like coming? Or because we like some of the people? And we like singing. Everybody likes singing. And Megan, she's a pretty good preacher. We like to hear her preach, right? Why do we come? Many of you responded to Megan's sermon last week and wrote some things down, and Megan read every one. And you responded to that question he asked last week, that Jesus asked, "What do you want me to do for you?" And there were different phrases down, but some of them were things like this. I want to be more like Jesus. Or I want my life to be a good witness for Christ. Jesus' response to your responses is pretty blunt. If you want your life to be more like mine, if you want to be a more effective witness for me, then do what I tell you to do. Don't expect Jesus just to tap you on the head and voila, you're more Christ-like. Being like Christ in our lives takes real effort. It takes discipline and structure and courage. Whether you're a teen, a child, or an adult, it takes dying to self. That self that says, "I'm trying to forgive," and it replaces it with pure obedience that says, "I forgive you as God in Christ has forgiven me." It takes intentionality. It takes an awareness of our own shortcomings so that they can be overcome for Christ. I'd like to present you with a little challenge this morning. And some of this it's more important, and I say this for myself. You know, as I get older, I notice that my memory is just not as good as it should be, right? Marie walked in there a few minutes ago and asked me to, "Where is this scripture?" And it's a scripture I know well. I couldn't think. But we talked for a few moments and we decided it was about Hebrews 12, right? Okay. Used to be able to pop right in. Now I know it's somewhere in the New Testament, right? And I will find it, but it's just not what it used to be. I need memory help. And it becomes more important as the years go by. But I'd like to say to you, we all do. If we're going to be disciplined and intentional about our faith journey, we need to develop some of those things, those disciplines. So here's what I'd like to challenge you with this morning. Come to church, bring a pencil or a pad with you, or a pen, whatever you like to write with, and start to write some notes while the preacher's preaching. It's not a love note. This is not about what you're going to have for lunch or, you know, passing the note down to the party beside you, but a note about what the Word of God is teaching you in that moment. Hopefully, we don't all sit here and kid ourselves and think that the devil doesn't, you know, leaves us alone while we're in the sanctuary. We hope and pray that's true, but if you're like me, there's constantly things seeping into our brain. Like, I think I dumped all the stuff in the crock pot. Did I put the chicken in the chicken and rice? I wonder, what was the sermon about? It's very easy, isn't it, folks? Our minds are divided, and they wander freely. How do we develop disciplines that begin to bring us closer to our Savior? one I might encourage you to do is write some notes. How can we minimize distractions? If Tom Brady were to walk through here today, would we all stop and look? Is Tom Brady the most important thing in the world? Seth's not sure, is that? All right, now, okay. While we're here, there's nothing more important than God our Father and Jesus our Savior, right? Always remember, when we're here in worship, we have an audience. You're not the audience, right? Who's our audience when we're here worshiping? Our Father and our Savior. Always helps me when my mind is wandering to think about, don't worry about Megan. Worry about the fact that when we're here worshiping, we have an audience of one. Can you see that, people? Forgot I didn't have a headset on. Sorry, guys. God our Father is our audience when we worship together. Some things to help us with disciplining our minds. God's words of instruction for us are real and true. We have a part in that too. What the preacher tries to do is to make sure we understand God's word enough to, and his leadership in our lives enough to follow through on them. To be doers of the word, not just hearers. Way too often I hear people say, wow, my preacher was really on fire today. Really? What was he or she preaching about? And all you get is a blank stare. All that is remembered is that the preacher was on fire. Come to Jesus. Truly listen to him. Obey him. This is what Jesus wants from us and for us. He wants us to come to him, listen to his words, obey his instructions. And if we don't, then he asks us, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I say? This question is a hard-hitting question that I hope leaves some impact on each of us today. Did you know that to repeat a person's name is a Hebrew expression of intimacy? Here's some examples. When God speaks to Abraham at Mount Moriah, as he is about to sacrifice his son Isaac, he says, Abraham, Abraham. Or when God encourages Jacob in his old age to take a trip to Egypt, he says, Jacob, Jacob. Or when Moses was called from the burning bush, Moses, Moses. Or the call of Samuel in the night, Samuel, Samuel. Or David's cry of agony for his son, Absalom, Absalom. Jesus' cry of desperation from the cross, my God, my God. Where Jesus confronted Martha when he warned Peter and when he wept over Jerusalem, in each case the word was repeated for intimacy's sake. When he asked the question, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I say? It seems like maybe he was trying to say, why do you act like we're close, that we have a good personal relationship with each other, and then disregard what I say? This question, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I say, is for those of us who claim to follow Christ, yet maybe our actions show differently. That's why the word hypocrite is so quickly attached to people like you and me. don't want to go to that church. They're a bunch of hypocrites. I always say, that's me. Come on. And it's accurate in the purest definition of the word. I am a hypocrite. I say that Jesus is my Lord, meaning that he is the ultimate final authority of my life. And yet I certainly do not do as he would have me do every hour of every day with every breath I breathe and every word I say. I don't. Do you? A young Korean man traveled a great distance to the home of the missionary who had led him to Christ, then announced his reason for the visit. I've been memorizing some verses of the Bible, and I want to quote them to you. The missionary listened as the young man recited without error the entire Sermon on the Mount. He recommended the young man for his remarkable feat that he had accomplished. Then, once a missionary, always a missionary, he cautioned the young man not only to say the scriptures, but to practice them. The man responded, "Oh, that's the way I learned them. I tried to memorize them, but they wouldn't stick. So I made a plan. First, I'd learn a verse, and then I'd put it into action. After that, I found I could remember them." He had come to Christ. He had truly listened to his words, and he had put into action what he had heard. Trust and obey. Now listen to what Jesus says happens to those who follow through on what they've heard and those who don't. "I will show you what someone is like who comes to me, hears my words, and acts on them. That one is like a man building a house who dug deeply and laid the foundation on rock. When a flood rose, the river burst against that house, but could not shake it because it was well built. But the one who hears and does not act like a man who built a house on the ground without a foundation, when the river burst against it, immediately it fell, and great was the ruin of that house." As disciples of Jesus, we don't have the authority to pick and choose what we want to obey from God's word and what we don't want to obey. If Jesus truly is our Lord, and especially our Lord, Lord, then we make the changes we need to make in our lives to come directly behind him as a follower. It doesn't mean our lives will be without trial and trouble. It means that when trial and trouble come, we have a solid foundation of faith that will help us keep standing in the midst of that. Only you and the Lord know where you are. He alone knows your heart. If you're a little boy or a little girl, then follow Jesus as a little boy or a little girl. Pray to him as a little boy or a little girl. And be a little boy or a little girl who follows him at home, at school, and with your friends, and with your family. If you're a teenager, you might be saying that you're going to wait a while until you're ready to follow him. You believe, but to truly obey, you're not quite ready for that. You have some fun you need to have first. Maybe when you get out of high school, or you get married, or you have a kid or two. Allow me to say that as the days go by and we keep saying, "Not yet, not yet," the devil makes it easier and easier to say no to Jesus and yes to Satan. When the principal calls you down to the office, it's best not to ignore the call. When Jesus calls, whenever that happens in our lives, it's best to respond right away, right now. Because this world we live in is shifting. It's ever shifting. We don't know what tomorrow will bring. So today is the day to start building a solid foundation. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. May the words of that hymn and the words of the scripture for today settle into our hearts. May that be true. Let's pray together, folks. Heavenly Father, we know that we have failed to come to you. We have failed to truly listen to you. We have failed to do as you say. We have listened to our friends, to people on TV, to non-Christian leaders, to our own desires. Instead of listening to and following what you say is right, we are so incredibly blessed to have your word. Forgive us for neglecting it, hardly ever reading it, dismissing it as something we can't understand, so we don't even try. We're expecting others to feed it to us like we're nothing but babies. Help us to want to grow up in your word, to follow your ways, and to shine your light for all to see. Thank you that you do forgive us and that your leadership can take us forward, Lord. Help us to start or continue building that firm foundation on truth, your truth, that you have given us. Oh, that you would help us to not just call you Lord, Lord, but that we would do as you say and be followers of you to your glory and for the building of your kingdom. That's our prayer, Lord. Amen.